Some people live their dreams. Some people close their eyes. Some people's destiny passes by. There are no guarantees. There are
to see if it's myth or reality. WBC heavyweight champion Trevor Berbick has his own sense of destiny. In 1981, he burst upon the boxing scene by extending then WBC champion Larry Holmes 15 rounds.
You can hear Berbick talking to him.
Later, a stunning upset over the reigning WBC champion, Pinklin Thomas, then thought to be the best in this scramble for the unification.
And new WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Trevor Berbick.
Now Mike Tyson attempts to become a younger heavyweight champion than 23-year-old Joe Louis, younger than a 22-year-old Cassius Clay, or even a 21-year-old champion, Floyd Patterson. After just 20 years and 4 months, Tyson attacks the record books.
So right, a counter right hand by Mike Tyson is invited.
There was an uppercut.
Davy Pearl looking very closely. And that's all. It's over.
Tonight, the old tiger faces the young lion as the heavyweight unification series continues on HBO. Outside, a cool, crisp night in the desert. One has to think even the gaming tables will empty a bit during the next hour or so. And we are live from the Las Vegas Hilton in Las Vegas, Nevada, where WBC champion Trevor Berbick defends his crown against Mike Tyson. It's scheduled for 12 rounds. Throughout the history of this great sport, celebrated heavyweights have emerged to capture the public's imagination. As they stand on the threshold of the title heavyweight champion, the hype is over. The names like Ali, Marciano, Lewis, and Dempsey each seize the opportunity. Now this Las Vegas crowd and millions around the world wait in judgment as Mike Tyson tries to prove he is deserving of all the attention as the next great heavyweight champion. A formidable WBC champion, Trevor Berbick, stands in his way. Hello, everybody. I'm Barry Tompkins, along with Larry Merchant and Sugar Ray Leonard. Welcome to Las Vegas. We'll answer a couple of questions tonight. First of all, is all the talk about this young upstart, the most promising heavyweight they say to come along in decades, just that? And is the champion, Trevor Berbick, worthy of the title that he holds? Larry Merchant, they've said that the heavyweight division is a group of indistinguishable retreads pursuing a confusion of titles. Now all of a sudden along comes Mike Tyson, and everybody that I've talked to involving this fight says this is the Tyson fight, Tyson this, Tyson that. But Trevor Berbick is the champion and nobody's talking about him.
I don't think there's any doubt that most people are viewing this event more as a coronation than as a contest, and it's perfectly understandable, really. because they're expecting and even hoping that Mike Tyson fills a vacuum in boxing. The absence of a real sensational young champion who's willing to fight anyone, everyone, and often. What we have to wonder is whether a 20-year-old heavyweight can really take that responsibility and be the boy king. We have to wonder about it because he hasn't really been tested yet. So it requires a sort of leap of faith to believe that, and I'm ready to make the leap.
Speaking of the leap, Sugar Ray Leonard, this is a quantum leap now for Mike Tyson. He hasn't fought anybody the caliber of Trevor Berbick. You've been in this situation. All of a sudden, it's a championship. You could feel it all around the Hilton here tonight. There's a lot of electricity going on. You've been in the spotlight situation. For Mike Tyson, is it too much too soon?
Well, but I feel it's now or never. And the reason I say that, because, see, Mike Tyson, because of his talent, he's been brought along, he's been marketed, he's nurtured, he's been extremely active. I think it's prime time for him. And the reason I feel that so confident about Mike Tyson is because he goes into the ring with such an aggression that very few guys can deal with it. So I have high hopes for Mike Tyson tonight.
Again, everybody's talking about Mike Tyson. Nobody's talking about the champion, Trevor Berbick. He is a man of very few pretensions. As a matter of fact, he virtually has made a career out of being the underdog. When he's the underdog, he wins. He's not really liked or disliked, but he has an ally, he says, that's never failed him. During the week, Trevor Berbick goes about his business as the WBC heavyweight champion of the world. But come Sunday morning, he's in a different arena, where his instructions do not come from a referee or a manager or a corner man.
Shake hands, good luck to both of you.
Trevor Berbick makes it his business to get close to God and practice his heartfelt religion. It's been a part of his life since he was a teenager. And for the last 16 years, this heavyweight champion sought the glory of his religious traditions.
But I was looking for something that we call the old-fashioned church, where people really express their feelings about God and not ashamed to dance to the tune and the music they love, and to just express themselves freely in the Spirit of God. It's always inspired me when I come here and see people that come out to sing praises unto the Lord and to dance.
The good music, the good music. You know, people say sometimes they go to parties, they say, you never dance. I say, it's not my music.
Trevor found the warmth and love he was looking for at the Moments of Miracles Church here in Las Vegas. As an ordained minister, he preaches the gospel with Senior Bishop John Irving and his wife, Prophetess Amanda.
Travis said, well, this is the place for me. He said, wherever I go, that I want the church to be with me. And whenever I fight, I want the church to be where the people can see the work that I am doing, not just on a fighter, but a man of God that working, that he build the kingdom of God, that it might be built through us.
We have a thing going that we call the World Series. World Heavyweight Boxing Series. They want to see who is the supreme of them all. I have a journey. I have something to conquer. Because I have to show the world that my God is supreme. Yes, I work hard. I train. I prepare myself physically. Yes, I'm a soldier of the cross. And I will defeat all devils that come my way. This is my calling. And I will do it in fine style and fine grace. Because I love my Lord.
Berbick's road to the heavyweight championship was not paved with gold. More often than not, he entered the ring as the underdog. His first attempt was in 1981 against then WBC champion Larry Holmes. Although he was the first man to go 15 rounds with Holmes, the championship eluded him. When he took on Greg Page, Trevor Berbick again surprised the boxing world and his opponent. After 10 rounds of furious flurries, Trevor had earned a unanimous decision. But against Ronaldo Snipes, Berbick once again tasted defeat. Starting with an early knockdown, Snipes dominated the fight and appeared to end Trevor's quest for a title. But 4 years and 10 fights later, Berbick entered the ring against Pinklin Thomas. Nothing could shake the faith of Trevor Berbick.
I think many times that things look impossible, and I had to call back into my faith and to reassure myself that
I can do it.
Heavyweight champion of the world, Trevor Berbick.
I wasn't supposed to do this. I wasn't supposed to have really still be here in the game. And I overcome it without a scratch, without a scratch or a scar on my face. And that showed me that there's a guiding light protecting me when the demons try to destroy me. So how can I ever forget that he always guided me and lead me and protect me?
The Moments of Miracles Church is not Trevor's only pulpit. He shares his strengths and beliefs once a week with the inmates at the Southern Nevada Correctional Center. In a classroom that sometimes transforms into a makeshift chapel, a small group gathers to partake in the reading of the gospel and to find comfort and encouragement through the words of a proud and humble champion.
We have liberty, and the prisons cannot keep us in. And you know that he forgives us. So therefore, we're looking at a different life, a new life, to come out in a new world and be a new man with new inspiration, new motivation. Well, I hope that I leave the message behind that the same God that saved them and the same God that gave me a successful life and a career will do the same for them when they leave this place, will continue to be their friend, their savior, and guide them along to great success in life.
Will the circle be unbroken by and by?
I have to show the world that I stand for Christ, and when I do it good, and I do it to win. And when it's all over, I want to give all the glory to God.
And so coming up here on HBO, it is the battle for the WBC Heavyweight Championship between the champion, Trevor Berbick, and the challenger, a most talked about challenger, 20-year-old Mike Tyson. Now with more on the champion who just won't seem to go away, here's Larry Merchant.
Trevor Berbick is a mysterious, eccentric character held together by faith in himself and in his religion. And Mike Tyson had, and in a very real sense, still has, cussed D'Amato. D'Amato was also a rather curious character in the boxing world. Trainer, teacher, self-styled philosopher, and a sort of mad scientist of the ring. One of his credos was that prize fighting, professional prize fighting, is entertainment. So that prize fighter should be entertaining, aggressive, crowd-pleasing. All of his fighters were that. And many people believe that Mike Tyson is his ultimate creation. This generation's Dempsey or Marciano or Frazier. But there was another D'Amato credo that you don't match your fighters too harshly. You don't overmatch them. He was very, very cautious in matching his fighters. So we really don't know about Mike Tyson. He's never even fought a top heavyweight yet. Tonight he has to prove himself against a professional, a champion. I sort of think that Cus D'Amato would approve of this match.
Something distracting you. And remember, it's always good to throw the punch where you could hit him and he can't hit you. That's what the science of boxing is all about.
It's been a year since he passed away, but his words are still heard. Cus D'Amato was, in a sense, the modern-day father of boxing. He often said, "What I do is discover and uncover." In the 40s, it was Floyd Patterson, and in the 50s, it was Jose Torres who he transformed into a champion. But perhaps his greatest prize was the 13-year-old boy brought to him 7 years ago from a nearby correctional institution. The uncovering process would now begin.
With me, a guy comes to me with a spark. I fan the spark until it becomes a flame. I feed the flame until it becomes a fire. Then I feed the fire until it becomes a roaring blaze. That's what I have to do.
But that spark turned into something much more than a boxing relationship.
When I was 14, Tyson to tell me about all this. We talk about the old fighters or something, and then we go to another hour, we talk about girls. It was just like my big brother, it was my father talking about my father.
Within 2 years of their meeting, the old professor legally adopted his rising star. Their destiny had begun.
Cuss always strived. He said, you could be the champ, even at a young age. And I believed in him. I developed that kind of confidence in him. And we just made it, that was the destiny, no matter whatever happened. And he discussed times that he wasn't feeling well and he doesn't think he's going to be around. But he said, no matter what, the job must go on.
Last November, Customato died of pneumonia. In the Catskills, where he worked with so many fighters, a part of the gym is dedicated to him, but not as a means of remembrance, rather for the teachings and beliefs of Customato that remain very much alive today. And Mike Tyson is not alone.
The guy threw a wide left hook, you get hit with a straight right hand inside the left hook, the hook can go around.
But you aim it here and bring the same hand, when he hits here, his life will bring it down. Even if he's coming, his life will bring it down, bang, over here, bang, with the left hook here or here.
And you get hit, bang, you get, oh, you get excited and your head comes up, your hands. When you get hit, that's when you gotta be calm.
And so it was for 6 years, day in and day out. The master instilled in the student his experience, his thoughts, and his expertise. He used words to inspire, words to teach, words to live by, words that are believed in to this day.
Fear is like fire. You let it get out of control, it will destroy you and everything around you. You manage to control, it can make it work for you.
No, you know what I like about? It's about the coward and the hero, that both of them feel the same.
It's what they do that makes them different. In other words, the hero feels just as frightened as the coward.
But it's just that the coward, he runs, instead of the hero, he feels the same, and he has the discipline, and he just makes himself go through whatever has to be done.
It's what he does that makes him a hero, and what the other fellow doesn't do that makes him a coward.
It was D'Amato's philosophy to build will rather than skill. With Mike Tyson, he has succeeded. The fear and the fire still burn, but so do other feelings.
Well, you know, it really is difficult because I did miss him a lot. But even besides, before when Cuss was around, I was always that way. I used to always keep things to myself. I always kept things to myself. But it's just that I let some things out. I spoke to him about some things that were on my mind. But one thing's been on my mind now, I don't talk to anyone about it.
It seems as if this was how it was meant to be. Customato knew that the day Mike Tyson entered the ring to fight for the title, he would be by himself.
I succeed when I make that fellow become champion of the world and independent of me. Because when he's independent of me, I have succeeded. He has succeeded when he becomes champion. I have succeeded when I made him independent of me. He doesn't need me anymore.
The prophet had a way with words. But you have to wonder what he would be saying to Mike on this night, the culmination of a dream.
If Cuss was around, and I was fighting for the title, he would tell me things. And he would describe the way Berbick would fight. Because I'm sure if he was around, he would have watched Berbick coming out of his ears. And he would describe the way Berbick fight and explain, this is what I would do. And so I would tell him, yes, but just don't worry about it, because everything's going to be all right. And he knew not to worry about it. No matter what happened, the job has to be done.
And so you have to have the feeling that Mike Tyson has a little bit of Customato with him. There you see, just 21 months as a professional to his first title fight. Joe Louis, the closest to him, more than a year behind him. So Mike Tyson, youth, no question about it. Now, will it be served is the question that we'll be answering tonight. And of course, I really haven't heard or felt as much anticipation, Ray and Larry, about a heavyweight championship fight as I felt in the last hour or so in a long time. And I don't know if it's just that we're kind of all sitting back saying, how good is Mike Tyson really? This fight has brought everybody out of the woodwork, I'll tell you.
Yeah, I think one of the ways we recognize it is when celebrities come out, because they recognize that something big is about to happen. And if you want to know what the cost of being a celebrity is, tonight it's $400, because ringside is $600. But all of these showbiz folks have paid $1,000 to be in the VIP section.
And that was sold out. You couldn't even get into the VIP section, really. In fact, Eddie Murphy was around here. He was kind of a latecomer. You saw him just a moment ago. There's Tommy Hearns, guy that you're infinitely familiar with, Ray. Michael Spinks, heavyweight champion. And Larry Holmes, of course, the
former heavyweight champion. I mean, this has brought out the greats and the near greats, and I'll tell you, it's only the greats that are ringside. Speaking of the greats.
Muhammad Ali and his new wife, Lani, his fourth wife. And somewhere back there is Archie Moore as well.
20 years and 4 months, that's the age of Mike Tyson. He is trying to surpass Floyd Patterson, who at 21 years, 11 months, became the heavyweight champion of the world. Mike Tyson told us yesterday, yes, that's important to him, he'd like that, but he would also like to be the youngest undisputed heavyweight champion
exactly.
of the world.
Exactly. There's a bit of an asterisk with this because Patterson was undisputed champion. Tyson is fighting for one-third of the title.
So Mike Tyson keeping folks waiting here, and perhaps most importantly, he is keeping Trevor Berbick waiting. And this you have to feel, Ray, it's going to be perhaps as much of a mental fight as it is a physical fight.
Well, if it's going to affect anyone, normally it affects the challenger because he hasn't been through that type of experience before.
Yeah.
Both of these fighters, extremely imperturbable. We sat and talked to both of them. They both seemed very calm before the fight. I didn't really notice any kind of edginess about either of them.
Well, they both seem to be very relaxed and very confident. I tell you one thing about it. This may prove to be somewhat of a strategic fight on both fighters' part.
Another factor here, I don't know if it's a big factor or not, Angelo Dundee in the corner of Trevor Berbick, and now Mike Tyson.
Mike Tyson has come to this fight with his usual retinue, which includes a trainer and an assistant, and that's it. Two people, plus his managers, Luke Caton and Jimmy Jacobs. That's his entire entourage, and here he is.
Also wearing a sweatshirt. It's the first time that we have seen him do that. He usually comes into the ring bare-chested, just trunks, black shoes, no socks, black trunks.
Sockless, but not punchless, I should add, Barry.
Yeah, no question about it. In fact, yesterday we were talking to him about, I asked him, I said, when do you put your game face on? He put his arm over my shoulder, and he said, you know, this is no game. Tyson, 27 victories, no losses, 25 knockouts, and the only two that weren't were against competitors who ran on him. Quick Tillis was one of them, and Mitch Blood Green was the other.
I think Mike is visibly just trying to conceal his feelings, retain his calm. This is the first time he's been in an event anywhere near this magnitude, and some people get caught on it. But here is our path to the championship. This is the fifth fight of the series to determine one heavyweight champion. The winner of this fight will fight the winner of a rematch between Tim Witherspoon and Tony Tubbs, who will fight again next month. And then those two winners will meet, and finally against Michael Spinks for the undisputed title.
One other thing to point out too, you saw that Mike Tyson hasn't fought in 76 days, and yes, that's a long time for him, but since November 22nd, a year ago, 1985, he has fought 14 times, so it isn't that he has not been active. Now, what's going to be the key to the fight? A lot of people feel the uppercut. Ray, what about that?
Well, Barry, because style makes fights, and all fighters favor a certain punch. And in Mike Tyson, that particular punch is a debilitating uppercut. Here against Roberto, you see the uppercut. It's short, and that's the beauty of it. It's so effective because you can't see it coming. And here we take a shot at him and Marvis Frazier. Once again, the short, well-executed right uppercut. And that's the shot I think is going to work against Trevor Berbick. But he has to get close and inside.
Now, what does Berbick have to do to defend against it? That, of course, is probably as important as what does Tyson have to do to be able to throw it.
Well, Berbick has a better jab than people give him credit for. And what he needs to do to nullify the uppercut is to work that jab and keep it consistent as he did here against Pinkman Thomas.
What about the criticism of Trevor Berbick that he's a guy who punches from the outside in? And Mike Tyson is a guy who comes straight at you. Berbick, as he makes his way out of his locker room and toward the ring now, said, that's where I want him. I love it if he's going to be right on my chest. But his style doesn't seem to dictate that he would love it.
Well, inside, Berbick has a tendency to throw wide loop and telegraph punches. He can't do that against a guy as tenacious as Mike Tyson. He has to throw short punches and tie Mike up and break his rhythm.
Now, you saw that Trevor Berbick has not had a fight in 244 days as opposed to Mike Tyson's 76 days, but that pretty much has been the history for Trevor Berbick, perhaps not quite that long. He's been fighting for 10 years, and he's only had the 37 fights, and Mike Tyson, of course, with 27 fights in a shorter space of time, considerably shorter space of time, 1 year and 8 months. But Berbick has fought tougher opponents. We talked about the fact that the crowd doesn't either really like Trevor Berbick nor dislike him, and you can hear kind of a sense of apathy as he comes toward the ring.
And there is Angelo Dundee, who will be in Trevor Berbick's corner for this fight. Berbick changes trainers about as often as most fighters change sparring partners. And of course, Dundee has been in the corner of many, many champions. There's Berbick's record, 31-4-1. The meaningful fights he has all won have fought well. Fought people like Larry Holmes. He stopped Greg Page when nobody else had. And of course, the big upset over Pinklin Thomas. He was a 6 or 7 to 1 underdog against Thomas. He opened as a 6 to 1 underdog tonight, and those odds have come down to about 3 or 3.5 to 1 man to man, because the odds are just too big, people felt, given the experience of both fighters.
We talk about the psychological aspect of this fight. Berbick dressed in all black looks a little bit like the Wicked Witch of the West.
You know, and that's a psychological ploy. You know, Tyson has worn black in every one of his fights, so Berbick wanted to wear black as well. And I think it says something about his style as a fighter as well, which we'll get to in a moment. Berbick's official age, ring age, is 33. He says he's 32. We give him the benefit of the doubt. Mike Tyson says he's 5'11 and a half. We measured him against Ray Leonard the other day, and he looked more about an inch bigger than Ray at 5'10 and a half. Everything else speaks for itself. And here's our punch data, our computer toy that gives you a quantitative, not a qualitative view of the fighters. Trevor Berbick throws in the area of 50 punches around, lands a pretty good percentage. Mike Tyson throws fewer punches, lands fewer punches, but most of his punches are harder punches. Berbick's jabs in those two fights, he'll have to jab more tonight to keep Tyson off him. Tyson's uppercuts in 10 round fights, that's about 2 or 3 a round. He'll have to be on top of his opponent to be effective with the uppercut, of course.
And the WBC rules, the 10-point must system, there will not be a standing 8 count. A fighter can be saved by the bell only in the final round. The 3 knockdown rule, as in most championship fights, not in effect. And the ring doctor in the WBC, as opposed to the WBA, cannot stop the fight. So those are the rules. Now let's go up to the ring announcer, Chuck Hall, for the pre-fight festivities. Chuck.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would ask you all to please remain standing as we present the national anthem. And to present that national anthem this evening, the very talented and internationally famous vocalist, Mr. Lou Rawls.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in the air, they gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave over the land?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Hilton Center, where tonight the dynamic duo Don King and Butch Lewis, in association with the Las Vegas Hilton Hotel, presents Judgment Day, an evening of world championship boxing. These bouts are sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Dwayne Ford, chairman, with commissioners at ringside, Freddie Little, Sammy Macias, Herb Santos, and Sig Rogich. The executive director of the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Harold Buck. the officials assigned by that body for the next bout of the night. The judges are Harry Gibbs, Dave Moretti, and Ruby Ortega. The timekeeper is Mike Morabito. Counting at the knockdowns, Charlie Roth. The attending physicians at ringside, Doctors Donald Romeo and Flip Omanskio, and neurosurgeon Kazem Fathi. Your referee for the next bout of the evening is Mills Lane. This next bout of the evening, presented by the dynamic duo and brought to you on behalf of Miller Lite. This is the main event of the night. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBC Championship of the World. Introducing, in the blue corner, fighting out of Catskill, New York, weighing 221 and 1 quarter pounds. He is undefeated in his professional career with 27 wins, no defeats, 25 KOs. He is the challenger, Mike Tyson. And in the red corner, formerly of Jamaica, now fighting out of Miami, Florida, weighing 218 and one half pounds. His professional record consists of 31 wins, 4 defeats, 1 draw, and 23 KOs. He is the WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Trevor Berbick.
Now listen, if you get in close and I tell you to brace and stop punching, step back clean. Any questions from the challenger or chief second? Any questions from the champion or chief second? All right, let's get it on. Come on.
The key in this fight for Tyson is to be patiently aggressive, not to fling himself into clinches as he has done. The key for Berbick, in my judgment, is to hold him off and smother Tyson and hope for a long fight that wears him out.
Berbick says it's imperative he keeps his man in the middle of the ring. He says, Tyson will not push me back like he's pushed other fighters back, and I'll push him back. And I think therein is another key to this fight, Ray. If Berbick can push Tyson back, easier said than done, but if he can, then he can be in the hunt.
Well, what is, I feel, is imperative for both fighters to keep those hands hot.
Both wearing black, Berbick with the high black stockings. Left hook, Tyson.
What's Berbick's trying to do? He's trying to overpower Mike Tyson. And he's abandoning doing what he normally does best, and that is to use his whole body, to use those broad shoulders.
That was a big right hand by Tyson. This crowd is right into this fight, right at the bell.
I would not be surprised when these guys go down because they're throwing big shots and both fighters are a little cold, a little stiff here. A little tight.
Right hand, Tyson, and a left behind it. Berbick, as he told us he would, trying to go to the uppercut, so far ineffectively. Big right hand.
Tyson has to be patient, as Larry stated, because he's fighting a guy that's been in the ring with top caliber fighters. So he knows how to get a breather and get that second wind going.
Another big left hook by Tyson. I mentioned this earlier, but Tyson's punches even sound different than most heavyweights.
That was a temple of the uppercut by Mike Tyson. It wasn't a clean shot. Trevor appears to be trying to keep Tyson backing up, making him fight his fight.
Another good left hand by Tyson. And a right behind it, and Berbick is rocked. Berbick in trouble here. Berbick just trying to get through the round. He's hurt, no question.
Was a big, big round for Mike Tyson, not only because he showed he had faster hands and beat Berbick to the punch, but because he did show the patient aggressiveness that we talked about earlier. Always coming forward, Tyson. And the punches are short because he's coming forward and harder to see. We have to remember that Trevor Berbick has never been hit by punches as hard as he's being hit in this fight. And you'd never know how a man is going to respond to that. Tyson is everything that people could have hoped for in that round.
Trevor Berbick, we should point out, has been down twice. There's another big shot by Tyson. Berbick in a heap of trouble. Down he goes.
The punches are coming in such a succession that Berbick can't deal with them. They're short, powerful, devastating punches.
Is still hurt. Berbick still seems to be not on solid legs at all here, Ray.
Well, again, you notice that my man is being patient. Tyson's being very, very patient, which was a big concern from a lot of other boxing people. He's being patient against a guy that has a great deal of experience. He's not wasting any punches.
Trying to tie Mike Tyson up here, just kind of hang on and get the cobwebs out. Oh, another big right hand, and Berbick is in trouble again.
Tyson is perpetual motion, and the reason he's so dangerous, bro, because he continues to throw his punches. One thing I've noticed in Tyson, he actually turns southpaw because he can knock you out with either hand. He has good leverage because he keeps his balance.
He missed with that uppercut, but didn't miss by much. Was a right to the body and an uppercut to the head, and Berbick is down. This one is going to be over, I believe. It's over. That's all, and we have a new era in boxing.
Mike Tyson fought as perfect a fight as a man of his type of ability could possibly fight. He fought a very strong man, an experienced man. He was unfazed by the magnitude of the event. There is no praise high enough for Mike Tyson for fulfilling all of boxing's hopes for what he's done here.
Amen. Well, that is just as complete a victory as I can remember seeing in the years I've done this sport.
Well, it makes you speechless because of the way that Tyson demonstrated his talent. Here, the right hand that put Trevor Berbick in a great deal of trouble, and here's the first knockdown. Again, another looping right hand, and Tyson punches very well with both hands. It was a good display of punching power by Mike Tyson.
And again, just to underscore the theme that Larry Merchant said,
well, the final knockdown, we didn't see that beautiful uppercut too often. In fact, Tyson didn't need it. But it was a short left hook that did away with Trevor Berbick.
Just tremendous shots and very quick hand speed. He set up the last knockdown with a shot to the body and came right back behind it. And you could see at this point that Trevor Berbick was not about to get back up.
To understand the punching power of Mike Tyson, all you have to do is watch this replay. And Trevor Berbick has a very durable chin. He has never been hit that hard, that often by any fighter.
Here's another look at it. Watch the shot to the body. There it is. Missed with that right hand.
It's such a short left uppercut, left hook, I'm sorry. And it was a one-punch knocker out, pretty much. It was not accumulation of punches.
Just devastating punches. But again, as I started to say, to underscore the theme of this fight, as Larry Merchant mentioned, patience. It was a different Mike Tyson than we saw. He just tried to overpower people before, run at them, and just be bigger and stronger and faster. But tonight, I didn't see him waste too many punches at all.
Well, Tyson knew, I think he knew what to expect from Trevor Berbick. He felt that Berbick was somewhat crafty and very slick inside. But Mike Tyson did what Mike Tyson normally does, and that's fight.
Yeah, and he does, that's with a capital F also. Well, I don't, you know, he just answered all the critics. Not that he had that many critics to begin with, but the questions that we talked about, you know, is it too much too soon? He really hasn't fought a named talent. Well, that will no longer be talked about, I'm sure. We will talk more about it, however. But right now, let's go up to the ring announcer, Chuck Hall. We'll get the official decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Mills Lane stops the bout at 2 minutes, 35 seconds of the second round. The winner by a TKO and youngest and new WBC heavyweight champion of the world, Michael Tyson.
So Mike Tyson, the youngest heavyweight champion in history at 20 years, 4 months, 22 days. What a victory for him tonight. You know, the thought that I had as Mills Lane was counting out Trevor Berbick was, what must Michael Spinks be thinking at this point?
Well, he knows full well there is a monster lurking somewhere out there in the boxing ring. And Tyson being the youngest heavyweight. For my son Ray, he's 13 today. Happy birthday, son. I'll be home tomorrow. God bless you.
That's right. I was going to say that, didn't get to it because of the second round. In fact, that may finish second to the fact that Eddie Murphy, who's here, phoned little Ray. Little Ray isn't so little anymore. I got to point out to you, not the same kid you saw in those commercials. But for Mike Tyson, not exactly little Mike either, 221 pounds. You know, he's a guy who you feel now, he's not just going to say, okay, I'm the champion and just let up. Let's go up to the ring right now. Larry Merchant is with the new heavyweight champion. Larry?
Mike Tyson, 20 years old, a heavyweight champion. How does it feel to be wearing this belt?
Well, the moment I waited for all my life since I started the game of boxing. And as everyone said, that Berbick didn't have a chance. Berbick was a very tough, very strong, in fact, very strong. I was never expecting him to be as strong like that. I knew he was strong, but I didn't expect him to be as strong as me. And he was very strong. But I was calm, and I was timing my punch. Every punch I do a bad intention in a vital area.
Everybody thought that the magnitude of this event, your youth, the fact that you have been a little too impatient in past fights, might make this a longer fight. How did you feel coming into this fight? How are you prepared to fight him?
Well, I told everybody I anticipated on a knockout because I was so calm, so relaxed, and I had so much belief in myself. But my trainer, Kevin Rooney, and I want to get in here. We sacrificed so much and we put in so much, and I just knew we couldn't fail.
What was your plan? What did you feel from him in the first round?
Well, my plan was to stick my jab in his face, as you saw. It was hard in his face, and every punch was to throw with bad intention.
That he did. We're going to take a look at the final knockdown to show. And would you describe it for us, Mike?
Yeah, look at every punch. I'm right
bad
here.
Intention.
Bad intention. Mess miss.
That miss. He's lucky.
And I miss weight and bone. Daddy, right off the temple. Right off the temple.
He's easy to hit. The guy's open for everything. Look at that.
That's all genre. I'm the youngest champion ever in the history of the sport. My record will last for immortality. It will never be broken.
And we're going to unify.
Why is it so important for you to be immortal, to have a record that you feel nobody will ever break?
Because I want to live forever.
That's all right.
Did he ever hit you with anything?
He threw some punching glass at me, but Even if they hit this, connect, I refuse to get hurt. I refuse to get knocked down. I refuse to lose. There's no way in the world I was going to go out this ring walking. I had to be carried out. I had to be dead. There's no way I was going to leave this ring alive.
It looked early in the second round that he had already recognized your power and that he was starting to hold on and just survive even as early as that.
Well, I don't know about that. If that was so, that was his problem. I was coming to destroy and win the heavyweight championship of the world, which I'd done. And I'd like to dedicate my fight to my great guardian, Customato. And I'm sure he's up there and he's looking and he's talking to all the great fighters and saying his boy did it.
He's smiling, that's right.
What are your ambitions from here on out?
To unify the title.
Will you consider yourself really the youngest champion until you unify the title?
Well, I consider myself the youngest. Look at the magnitude. Look what I draw here. Look at the fans. Everybody came to see this fight. This fight was unbelievable. It's an exciting moment of my life. I still can't believe the audience and everything. And I would have to say the championship fight.
Customato, when he first saw you at the age of 13, 14, he said to you, stay with me and you can be the heavyweight champion of the world.
Yes.
And you said, how do you know that? You just saw me.
I said, this is a crazy old white dude.
What do you think he saw in you?
I couldn't tell you. He's a genius. You can't, everything he said happened. Isn't it true? Everything he said happened with me.
That's right.
Was it that he saw in you just strength, or did he see, do you feel some kind of character strength that would carry you?
Cuss always depended everything on character and determination. He saw I had the character, but not the experience. But he saw that I was good enough to fight more experienced fighters and win.
Next month, Tim Witherspoon fights Tony Tubbs. You will fight the winner. Give us your assessment quickly of that fight, and what do you think about your chances against either of them?
I would love to fight the winner. I don't know who the winner is going to be, but I would love to fight the winner. I'm champion of the world. I'll fight any man alive, and I feel I could beat anyone in the world. And I'll take on all comers.
Thank you very much, Mike Tyson. That interview was longer than the fight. And back to ringside.
Okay, thanks very much, Larry Merchant. Nice interview with an awfully nice guy. You know, yesterday when we were talking with Mike Tyson, he said that he was asking Customato, he said, what am I going to do when you're gone? Because Cuss always used to say, you know, I'm an old guy, I'm not going to be here too much. And Cuss said to Mike Tyson, he said, that's how you'll find out if there's life after death, because when I'm gone, you're going to keep going. And he dedicated that fight to him tonight. Let's take a look at some of the numbers from this fight off our punch stat statistics. And they are indicative, of course, of just exactly how the fight went, Ray.
Well, there's a lot of punches thrown by Mike Tyson, a lot of short punches. And unfortunately, we can't see how effective those punches are by the punch stat. But you see, it's been a lot of punches thrown.
It's interesting. I just don't know how you can sum up this fight. One word comes immediately to mind, and that is awesome. Let's go back up to the ring now, where Larry Merchant is with the loser, former champion, Trevor Berbick. Larry?
Trevor Berbick, you saw Mike Tyson from ringside in some of his fights. You've seen him now from inside. Yeah. What is your impression of him?
Well, I still can't believe that I got caught and fought the wrong fight. But I guess it did happen. I guess I did get caught and fought a silly fight. Angela said I was trying to prove this to myself that I could take his best shot and then laugh at it, but he said I got caught, so.
Did you feel that if you could show him you could take his best shot, that you would then be able to dominate him?
I would think that's probably what the game that I thought I could do, you know?
But was he a better puncher than you anticipated?
Yeah, he went pretty hard, because I felt it. It wasn't a one-shot knockout thing, but it was hard enough, and I said, well, I shake it for the second round.
Yeah.
And I said, I shake it out a second, and I said, he's going to come again, and I can kill his power. But apparently, I got caught like Angela said.
Was he faster than you expected?
Well, pretty fast, I saw it, but, I still can't believe, but, you know, I was trying to force myself to believe that I would overcome it.
You felt that his youth would be overcome by your experience and strength.
Yeah, I felt that I was strong, pretty strong, and that was the mistake I think I made.
Is that the hardest punches you've ever experienced?
It's a funny kind of punch because it comes at different angles.
You never saw them?
I'm not quite sure if I saw the one that hit me down here.
How would you rate him now against the other heavyweights in the tournament?
A very good fighter. Very good fighter.
Do you think he is the one in the tournament that will emerge as the youth
fight? I think he'll have a very good chance.
Are you going to continue to fight, Trevor?
If I get the right breaks.
Thank you very much, Trevor Berbick. The short and happy reign of Trevor Berbick is over. Back to ringside again.
I think again, Ray, what Trevor said probably
sums it up as well as anything else. Gee, yeah, that about says it. Here's the path to the championship then, who beat whom, and who's going to face whom to get to the ultimate, and that is the Unified Heavyweight Championship. Mike Tyson, of course, as we mentioned, will face the winner of the Tony Tubbs-Tim Witherspoon fight. That you will be able to see on December 12th here on HBO. It takes place at Madison Square Garden in New York City. So it'll be Tyson versus either Witherspoon or Tubbs, and then against Michael Spinks, that for the Undisputed Championship, probably sometime in May. Let's take a look at the final round, round two, Ray, and it was just a little bit of more of same following round one.
Well, a lot of punches thrown by Mike Tyson. Mike used both hands, very patient. He was able to hurt Trevor Berbick, and the key to the fight, he never let Berbick off the hook. Here again, he's right back on top of Trevor Berbick, throwing the left hook, waiting to get inside, and it was just a matter of time, Barry.
Did you have the feeling that even after the first round that Trevor Berbick really never got his legs back?
Well, the first time that Mike Tyson hit Berbick with a good shot and Berbick stood there, I said, well, this could be a long fight. But then all of a sudden, I saw that the knees of Trevor Berbick started to shake. So it was just a matter of time.
Well, Trevor Berbick, again, just looked to be kind of a stumbling fighter after about the middle of the first round when Mike Tyson first hurt him. Coming up toward the end of this go now. And Berbick, again, you can see he just doesn't seem to be fully attentive. He just doesn't seem to be all there, at least to this observer.
Well, another thing is Tyson has those short arms, so he's able to execute punches inside very closely, very effective, and get a great deal of leverage. Tyson puts his entire body behind, his whole hip behind each punch, so he's able to hurt guys with idle hands.
You know, the way we've seen Tyson fight in the past, it's just almost been reckless. Maybe it's the best way to describe it. Tonight, he was anything but reckless. He was very calculating.
Hands, he kept his hands high. Here he just plotting his man, staying aggressive, working the body, watch the left hook. That was the key punch that really put Trevor Berbick on Queer Street. And Berbick is a guy, don't get me wrong, Berbick is a guy with a pretty good chin, so that tells you the power of Mike Tyson.
You know, the other thing that strikes me too is it just seems that Mike Tyson just that quickly has emerged as a heavyweight champion. You know, we've always seen him be very soft-spoken, even when we've been with him privately, just three or four of us in a room. Very quiet guy, but you heard in his interview with Larry Merchant, obviously he was very excited, but all of a sudden he's acting like a champion.
Well, there was a sense of awe to Mike Tyson. He actually believed he was supposed to be champion, that he will be champion, that it was something that would be inevitable. And he made his dream come true. Mike Tyson became the youngest heavyweight ever.
And there was that big left hand.
It caught him on the forehead, as a matter of fact, and he displays so much power. I was impressed, quite impressed.
Just a tremendous victory. I mean, you just can't say it enough. I almost feel like we're being redundant here, but it was just awesome. Just a brilliant performance by Mike Tyson.
Well, he gives me inspiration because Hagler's next.
That's right.
Oh,
we're
going
to talk
good.
About that, too. Let's get back up to the center of the ring right now where Larry Merchant has a guest. Larry.
I'm with Jose Suleiman first. Jose is the head of the WBC. I want to talk to you, Jose, because the IBF is saying that Michael Spinks ought to fight someone else before he gets to the end of this tournament, and it seems to reflect the fact that some commissions don't want to see a unified champion. How does the WBC feel about that?
We want to see the unification of the title. I believe that if a champion needs dignity, the only way to get it is by beating the other one. I think that we saw the birth of a new era tonight. Sensational. As far as the WBC is concerned, we would do anything, no conditions whatsoever for the unification of the title.
Thank you very much, Jose. Now I'm with Butch Lewis, who is the co-promoter of this series and the promoter of Michael Spinks, the IBF champion. Michael, what do you think Butch, what is your position about what the IBF is saying, that they want you to fight someone else before you get to the final fight of this tournament?
Well, not speaking for the IBF, I respect all the organizations, and I will look forward to sitting down with Mr. Bob Lee, the president of the IBF, and he's certainly an understanding man, wherein Michael Spinks, who's been good for boxing as a light heavyweight champion, who unified the title as a light heavyweight champion, who is a great credit to boxing, and is now as heavyweight champion, I think that the IBF and its members will do what's right for boxing. rather than for one fighter.
Especially since they never even made Larry Holmes ever fight a mandatory defense of his of their title.
Well, Michael took the title away from me before he was due for a mandatory. Right.
One final question. We hear reports that you have already agreed to fight Jerry Cooney outside of the tournament, that you might be making an announcement soon. Would you comment on that?
Well, let me say this, Larry. If I ever fought Jerry Cooney, contractually, my contract with HBO allows me to do so.
Right.
So if that came about, I will make an announcement soon.
Would you fight him outside?
Contractually, we always been allowed.
Right.
Don't act like I can't do it, Larry. I'm allowed to do it.
Okay.
Okay,
Muhammad. You're allowed to do it, but only if he agrees to stay in the tournament. Would that be the conditions of the...
We won't discuss the contract here before all our audience,
okay,
Larry. But we at HBO and at Butch Lewis Productions know how the contract reads.
Thank you very much, Butch.
Thank you.
And Jose. Back to ringside, and I'll have a few final words about tonight in a minute or so.
That's what I like about Butch Lewis, to give you the shirt off his back. You got a little fight coming up in April.
A little fight? Well, I'm honored that Hack gave me an opportunity to fight for his crown. But the thing about it, he's been very, very admirable about the fact that we're going to fight each other April 6th. I'm looking forward to it. And I'm sure he is too, Larry.
What is that? You and Marvin are friends. They're pretty good friends. Is it difficult to fight a guy who you do like?
Well, you know, we have not had any type of promotional hype nor gimmicks, and even at the press conference that we've had, there was nothing derogatory said because we're both professionals, and there is no need to say anything out of the way about each other. But come April 6th, quite naturally, he says he's going to war. I will go to strategy because I don't believe in war.
What's your reaction to people's saying to you, Ray, I really wish you wouldn't do this. Why are you doing this?
Well, there are two sets of people. There are my fans, and there are people that are somewhat pessimistic. My fans don't want me to fight, I understand that, but they've rationalized with my decision. Other people, they say that because they are cynical in a sense, and I don't know, I guess it's just a matter of envy.
For real, for sure, one time once and then that's it?
One time, like I said, you can wear this bow tie one time.
All right, let's go back up to the ring and Larry Merchant.
Angelo Dundee, the famous trainer, once said of a Muhammad Ali opponent, he's human. My guy ain't. In the land of boxing, not being considered human is the sincerest form of flattery. And I think tonight we found out which fighter was human, and in boxing's terms, which fighter wasn't human. I don't know if Customato made out a will. I don't know who he made it out to. But I know that what he did do was to bequeath to all of us who love boxing, who love the spirit have these men, a young champion who can revitalize the game, but more important, shows us the passion of the game. There's no entrepreneurship in him. He's not being a fighter so that he can be something else. He is a pure fighter. He is the pure flame. Barry?
Ray, your thoughts. It really is refreshing almost, I think, to have a fighter like Mike Tyson in a heavyweight division.
It's refreshing because it's a young man that was on the horizon, became champion, and people respect him because he's always been clean cut. I think boxing needs that.
You know, the other thing, too, that Mike Tyson was telling us, a thing that Customato taught him as well, he said he taught me anatomy. He said, I know the liver. He said, I know the jawbone below the ear. He said, I know the floating rib. He said, I know the kidneys. And you know, tonight he hit every one of them.
Anatomy, the ribs, the kidneys, the jaw. Great. The guy could be a doctor.
Dr. Tyson. He's the champion. Well, be sure to join us each week then as Len Dawson and Nick Buonocani host Inside the NFL. We'll take you right through Super Bowl 21 with all the highlights, the interviews, and the features surrounding the National Football League.